It's hard to overstate the power of a lightning bolt. We normally think of static electricity as that cute little effect that makes our hair stand on end or stick a balloon to a wall, but the issue is one of scale. It's cute when the amount of charge is contained by a single balloon, but multiply that by the scale of your average thunderstorm and you're suddenly dealing with so much power that there's no technology on Earth that could effectively capture it. As the clouds slosh around in the sky and the charge builds and builds, eventually streams of charged particles start to escape, sometimes downwards. In response, this induces charges moving through objects on the ground to make little streams of particles reaching to the sky to meet them. When the two streams connect, suddenly all that energy is released in the classic lightning stroke that we see as a bolt of lightning. In that moment, gigawatts of power flow through the channel that's instantly created by the superheated gas turning into a plasma. There is, of course, the flash of light, and then a few seconds later, we hear the deafening crack of thunder from all the gas being displaced so quickly. But then the energy has dissipated, and all is quiet again, save for maybe the gentle pitter-patter of rain as charge starts to build up in the clouds once more. But when lightning strikes, a lot more stuff is actually released than just that flash of light and sound. What you're listening to may sound a bit like standing in the middle of a swamp at night, but not a single sound you're hearing was made by any living creature. Well, I mean, my narration is, but you get the point. This is what's called very low frequency radio, which is in the range of 3 to 30 kilohertz. The neat thing with these frequencies is that they're equivalent to the range of human hearing. So if we convert the radio signal directly to sound, we hear this cacophony of cracks and pops, amongst other sounds. There's a ton of natural phenomena, both that originate on Earth and also some from space, that contribute to this amazing natural soundtrack. Each sound comes from a particular source, and you can learn to pick out what things are and learn when to listen for them, as many require the correct combination of cosmic events happening to be heard. My favorite are called whistlers, which sound like this cool sci-fi descending tone. Starting with all those pops and cracks, as you probably figured out from the introduction, they all come from lightning strikes. When all that current flows through a bolt of lightning, it essentially acts as a giant antenna and radiates a pulse of radio waves at a variety of different frequencies, both in the VLF range and much higher in the megahertz or even gigahertz. But just because we pick up these powerful radio bursts doesn't mean that the strike was anywhere near the receiver. VLF radio is particularly interesting as it moves in ways that we think of as unusual when talking about radio. In almost any diagram and discussion of the high-frequency sorts of radio that we've used in previous videos, radio is described as moving in basically straight lines. If it goes further than line of sight of the transmitter, it's usually because it was able to bounce off of something, most often different layers of the atmosphere. But while VLF can do that, and we'll talk more about bouncing VLF in a moment, it can also hug the ground in what's called ground wave propagation. This lets it travel absurd distances and can even travel around the world several times if the conditions are right. This effect works better the more conductive the ground it's traveling over is, so big areas of salty water or wet conductive soil works very well to let VLF travel for potentially thousands of kilometers. This is because the radio induces charges in the ground that in turn tug on the wave, causing it to tilt downwards, allowing its trajectory to curve around the Earth. So if you get a VLF receiver and antenna and start listening, you hear this never-ending series of pops and cracks as thousands of lightning strikes happen all around the world. But you're still probably wondering where those chirps and animal-like noises come from. Those are also from lightning strikes, but in this case, rather than hugging the ground, the VLF traveled upwards into the atmosphere. As you may know, there are many layers to the atmosphere. Once you get high enough up, the air becomes so thin that radiation from space and the sun can ionize the gas and leave it charged, like a diffuse plasma. The point where this ionization becomes strong enough to interfere with radio signals starts at about 60 kilometers up. The region from 60 to 90 kilometers is known as the D layer, and the region from 100 to 150 kilometers is the E layer. Throughout the day, the levels of ionization in these layers changes, which allow or impede different radio frequencies from either penetrating through, or can act as a reflector to bounce radio signals off of. This is why we use high-frequency signals to talk with satellites, as those frequencies aren't affected by these layers and punch right through without reflecting. And for terrestrial signals, like AM radio, we often use lower frequency signals so that way we can take advantage of the giant reflector and bounce signals much further than they would otherwise travel. But VLF takes all of this even further. If some of the VLF pulse is sent skyward, it can get almost stuck between the two layers, which channels it and acts like a waveguide. The longer it travels, the more the pulse is stretched and distorted as different frequencies contained in it travel faster or slower through this natural waveguide. When it eventually escapes back down to Earth, we hear this almost musical chirp, which scientists call tweaks. Now for my favorite, the whistlers. Again, these start as lightning strikes, but they travel in an even stranger manner. As you know, the Earth is surrounded by a magnetic field. But what you might not be aware of is that many of the particles of radiation that come from the sun or space can get trapped by these field lines and travel along them, forming long streams of plasma in space. The particles will eventually follow these field lines all the way down until they hit the atmosphere, where they smack into gas molecules and give up their energy, which we see as the beautiful glow of the northern or southern lights. For a Whistler to happen, one of these plasma channels in space needs to have formed above a lightning storm. When the VLF pulse travels skyward, it can sometimes be channeled along these streams from one end to the other. Like tweaks, the signal is stretched, but the distances involved due to the giant arc through space are so long that the stretching is far more pronounced and you get that cool descending tone. On a spectrogram of the audio file, you can see them as these distinct curves. Sometimes, the Whistler will get reflected off the ground when it arrives and be sent back up the stream to where it came from. This process can actually repeat many times, and some researchers have detected over 100 echoes from a particularly good Whistler bouncing back and forth. Which is crazy when you consider how many hundreds of thousands of miles the signal would have had to travel to do that. It seems that the Earth's magnetic field can add energy to the Whistlers, which is what allows them to bounce back and forth so many times. But most of the time, you only get one Whistler, sometimes with an echo or two. Generally, you refer to the number of echoes as hops, so a Whistler with one echo is a two-hop Whistler, as the initial one is considered the first hop. But in order for lots of hops to happen and form what's called a Whistler train, the conditions really do need to be perfect, and you need a fair bit of luck. Primarily, the thing that's the most important for Whistlers to happen is that there's enough particles trapped in the field lines to form the streams the signal can travel through. The sun goes through an 11-year cycle, where right now we're in what's called solar minimum, and it's at its least active. This makes chasing Whistlers tricky, as there just isn't enough radiation to let the streams form regularly. So in order to get these recordings, I've been using a space weather app to tell me when the sun was more active. After things like a coronal mass ejection or other solar wind phenomena, there can be a huge spike in radiation hitting the Earth. So by monitoring what's called the KP level, you can find times when there's enough radiation for Whistlers to form, even during solar minimum. One final note is that to receive Whistlers, you need to be at the right latitude so that you're directly under the end of one of the field lines. The two ends of the field line are called the conjugate points, and while there are some maps out there, it's important to note that they're always changing and shifting around, so the maps are only an approximation. Because of where the magnetic field lines poke out of the Earth, this means you need to be above 40 degrees of latitude to hear them. But if the sun is active and lightning is happening at the other end of whatever field line you happen to be living under, you can sometimes pick up Whistlers. It also helps to be on the night side of the planet so that the plasma streams don't get bumped around by the normal solar radiation and can actually build up. Also, at night, the D layer disappears and the E layer is wispy, so the signals can pass through more easily. The ionization in those layers primarily comes from solar radiation, so on the night side of the planet with nothing to add new energy, the various charged particles can recombine to neutral gas atoms, and the layer becomes thin enough that VLF can go through. That said, it is still possible to pick up Whistlers during the day, it's just a lot more rare. The coolest part about Whistlers to me is that we've detected something that sounds a whole lot like them coming off of Jupiter with multiple spacecraft, which is a pretty strong indication of lightning happening in Jupiter's atmosphere. The final set of noises have a similarly cool origin. Rather than lightning strikes, interactions between cosmic rays and other radiation from space, interacting with Earth's magnetic field, can directly produce a variety of sounds and signals. When a high-energy charged particle, let's say an electron for the sake of discussion, encounters the Earth's magnetic field, it will spiral around the field line. As it does this, it necessarily has to lose some energy as it's constantly changing direction to maintain that spiral trajectory. This energy is in the form of what's called synchrotron radiation. Depending on the energy of things, this often manifests as radio emissions. Though if there's more energy in the particle before it starts to curl, you also get higher energy electromagnetic waves, which is how synchrotron machines on Earth generate their X-rays. They accelerate electrons in straight lines to very high energies and then have them curve suddenly to release a burst of X-rays. By far the best time to hear this is during high auroral activity, which is also typically the best time to listen for Whistlers as well. The northern lights, after all, are just the result of radiation hitting the atmosphere and ionizing it. So not only do you get the beautiful glow, you also get all sorts of radio noise. In fact, you can often detect an aurora by its radio noise, even if it's too dim to see with our eyes. For the most part, an aurora just sounds like a distinct hiss made from the billions of particles slowing down or slamming into the Earth's atmosphere. The last thing we'll talk about before getting into how we actually receive these signals is what's called a dawn chorus. As we've discussed, those ionized layers of the atmosphere get their energy primarily from radiation from the sun. So as you approach dawn and the light from the sun starts to reionize the atmosphere above you, it makes for the perfect conditions to stretch and shift all those cracks and pops, making the number of tweaks and chirps skyrocket. So for 2 to 3 hours before sunrise to a bit after dawn, you can listen and often hear what sounds like standing in the middle of a swamp. Okay, so now we can talk about how you actually receive any of this. The funny thing is, we've known about these signals for just about as long as we've had telephones. Back in the day when telephone lines were just long wires, people were hearing whistlers during their phone calls. Like all radio, the closer the total length of the antenna is to one half of the wavelength, the better it is at picking up the signal. So those long telephone lines and their rudimentary amplifiers made for perfect receivers. These days, you can buy a variety of different receivers that do the job without needing to install a many mile long wire. I picked up one of these Inspire VLF 3 kits, which come as a collection of parts that you put together yourself. What I absolutely love about this design is just how straightforward it is and how effective it is. The majority of the components are resistors and capacitors that are all clearly labeled, so if something ever broke, replacing a part is easy. The instructions on the website are very thorough, but I figured if I was going to deal with so many parts, it was best to learn from Adam Savage and null out my parts a bit before getting started. After that, it was just a couple hours of checking every piece as it was placed into the circuit and then soldering things in permanently. One note is that some components, like the LEDs and the dials, are soldered onto the opposite side of the panel, so be sure to pay attention or you're going to have to dig them out to fix that later. In case you can't tell, I'm a turnip and solder them on the wrong way the first time. But after that, everything just screws together and it's all powered by a 9-volt battery. Now before we take this out to the field for a test drive, I really only got this because I wanted to have a personal receiver as I've been fascinated by this for years. But a far more effective, cheaper, and frankly lazier method is to go to a website called abelian.org/VLF. The site gives you live access to real-time VLF receivers all over the world, which are often in far better locations than what you're going to be able to find near you. All of the recordings you've heard up until this point were recorded using this site. The whistlers, for example, were recorded from a station in Germany as it's the perfect location to pick up whistlers. Speaking of online tools, another great one is called microspherics. One thing lightning strikes generate, which we haven't really talked about yet, is a massive magnetic field to go with all the other things that come off them. By using a slightly different receiver, rather than picking up the radio, you can pick up the pulse from the magnetic field itself. This has the added benefit of being very easy to do direction finding with. So what various groups and weather networks have done is put these direction finding sensors all over the continent and connected them to the internet. Now if lightning strikes anywhere in North America or Europe, the networks are able to pinpoint where it struck down to within about 100 meters by coordinating the direction finding data from multiple sensors. Microspherics gives you a real-time map of these strikes, and it's really crazy to see just how many there are. Though it's less accurate than the systems that various governments use, so it doesn't even catch all of them. You can actually buy a special meter that will detect lightning near you using this magnetic field effect, and can even join the microspherics network by sending them your data. Okay, to wrap this up, let's finally give the new receiver a test. For this to work, you need to be as far away from power lines and ideally human-caused interference as physically possible. Our machines and systems throw out a huge amount of noise that's in the VLF range, so the further away from that you go, the better this works. You also need to be away from trees to get a good signal, as wood actually attenuates the signal. So a big open field far away from power lines and buildings is ideal. Here in Montreal, that can be a bit hard to find, but I managed to make do by hiking up the mountain. I managed to lose my nice telescopic antenna before filming this, so I just used a long copper wire and it totally worked fine. The receiver has a spot for both options for exactly this reason. The antenna is pretty short and one that's 3 to 10 feet long is better, but even then it worked remarkably well. After that you need to ground the receiver well, so I'm using a short wire tied to a long metal spike that I can drive into the ground. After that, just plug in some headphones, turn it on, and very slowly turn up the volume. If it sounds like a loud squeal, you either need to ground the receiver better or you're near some sort of interference. My audio recorder, for example, was throwing out a ton of noise, so I needed to keep it as far away from the antenna as possible to get my recordings. But when everything is working, you should start hearing the familiar pops and cracks. For the most part, I don't really use the receiver that often, though. It's great and an awesome tool to have if you're interested in this stuff, but I'm just not in a great geographic location to put it to regular use. So I mainly use it while I'm up north and further away from the city. But with Abelian, I can be in my pajamas and still get cool recordings like this and use a variety of online data like microspherics and space weather to pick good times to listen. And that way, I don't need to quickly hike up the mountain at 3 in the morning when there's a solar storm just to catch whistlers. One last note that I want to end on is sort of the opposite of what we've talked about thus far. We've mostly been talking about how VLF is affected by other things, but we haven't talked about how VLF itself can affect things. The Earth is surrounded by several distinct belts of extremely dense radiation known as the Van Allen belts. We've known about these basically since we started launching stuff into space, but what's really interesting is that they're actually getting pushed outwards. VLF isn't only natural in origin. One property of VLF that we haven't talked about is its ability to penetrate deep into the ocean, unlike most radio, which is stopped by only a few meters of water. So the military and others produce large amounts of VLF signals for talking with submarines and other communication applications. As we've collectively upped our VLF output as a species, it exerts a sort of pressure on the Van Allen belts, pushing them outwards. There's even some theories that if you could blast enough VLF at them, you could punch a hole through the Van Allen belts so that a spacecraft could pass through without being exposed to the massive radiation levels. I'm going to end the video with a few minutes of my favorite recordings cut together so that you can listen to the beautiful song of the Earth uninterrupted. But before I do that, I first need to say a huge thank you to my many supporters and patrons of the channel that make these videos possible. As always, I've put a bunch of links in the description if you'd like to read more about this incredible field and all the things we've learned about our planet thanks to people picking apart these strange signals. And I had to completely leave out many of the other interesting radio signals that come at us from space. But before the recordings, I also need to take a moment to thank today's sponsor, which is Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with more than 25,000 classes in design, business, and so much more. I've really been enjoying Jake Bartlett's Animating with Ease in After Effects class, as I'm constantly working to make the animations on this channel cleaner and continually more complex as we dive into technical topics like this. And Skillshare is a great place to learn all the tips and tricks you need to get started. Skillshare is giving away a free 2-month unlimited access trial to my subscribers who click the link in the description down below. And after that, it's only $10 a month. Premium membership gives you unlimited access so you can join the classes and communities that are just right for you. Click the link below to join more than 7 million creators learning with Skillshare and join groups to learn with like-minded individuals, give and receive feedback on projects, and find people with the same interests as you. Now, one last note before the recordings is I just want to quickly announce the winners of the Golden Thought Emporium logo giveaway from my last video before I leave you with the Song of the Earth. Congratulations to Jean-Baptiste B. and James Parsons Jr., who won the general and patron-only giveaways respectively. I'll be sending you both an email to get your shipping information, and we'll have these sent out to you soon. Now, without further ado, I leave you with the Song of the Earth, and I'll see you next time.